Antonio starting earlier this morning. And my proposal, our proposal, is that you were talking about creating materials before, but now we're going to work on assessing already existing materials. So it is kind of related. And what we want to do with you in this session is basically this. So I will be introducing the topic, the session. I will tell you the aim of the workshop. Then we will very, very briefly explain the six principles that we have prepared for this session. This will be a very, very brief explanation. And it will also be brief because we believe that what you have been dealing with in the earlier session is really very much related. We will have the same principles, but rearranged, so to say. So we will be doing that, and then after that, we will provide some activities for you to do, to assess some materials. And then we will conclude with some ideas. So this is the outline of the session. So the aim of the workshop. Well, the aim of the workshop, as I said, kind of briefly said before, is to be able to assess already existing materials. You know that there are plenty of materials out there. And sometimes we are not really sure about whether these materials actually work well, are being well organized, do they follow the principles that you have been seeing with Antonio in the previous session. So these are the six fundamental principles. Basically, our objective is to make learning deep, to obtain deep learning with our students, not surface learning. For this to happen, we've got six principles that we will explain. And this is it. I'm not going to say anything else. So let's go.
Okay, good morning, everybody. I'm very pleased to be here and to be delivering, giving this workshop with my colleague, Christina. I haven't got a powerful voice, so if at any point you feel like you're not listening to me, just please remind me to speak louder, okay? Let me go back to the beginning. To clear or not to clear, that is the question. This is a very famous quote. Does it ring a bell to you? To be or not to be, that is the question. Well, this is Shakespeare said so back in the 16th, 17th century. Well, the title of our joint workshop is basically analyzing materials and tasks for competent subjects. Those of you who are competent subjects, can you please raise your hands?
Content
subject teachers.
Most of them.
So most of you are competent teachers. Do you teach geography or history? No geography or history teachers. We've got a few maths teachers, biology, physics, chemistry, technology, music. We've got music, some music teachers, administration. So it's quite a heterogeneous group, as we can see. Okay, so Christina has already explained to you the structure of the workshop. Basically, we're going to go through six fundamental principles. We are very grateful that Antonio has already anticipated those principles. Then we are going to focus, as Christina has already said, on a set of materials that we have brought with us, and we want you to analyze them from six points of view, from six critical perspectives, and we'll try to wrap up this presentation with a handful of conclusions. So let's get serious now. Look at this comic strip. This is the perfect tail unit comic strip. Do you feel yourselves identified with this comic strip? You have been working very hard on the preparation of a tail unit, and you experience this at hand, moving. Here I have the perfect tail unit. And after implementing it in the classroom, after putting it into practice with your students, you realize it's not as perfect as you thought it would be. I guess you can identify with this convent street. Let me show you a video. It's a very deep philosophical video, and I want you to try and guess what the connection between this video and Khalil is. You will tell me at the end of the session.
It's a very complicated situation, Cousin Sonia. I'm in love with Alexei. He loves Alicia. Alicia's having an affair with Lev. Lev loves Tatiana. Tatiana loves Simkin. Simkin loves me. I love Simkin, but in a different way than Alexei. Alexei loves Tatiana like a sister. Tatiana's sister loves Trigor. Only likes physically, but not spiritually. Natal? With the firm of Truskov and Tuskov.
Natasha, to love is to suffer. To avoid suffering, one must not love. But then one suffers from not loving. Therefore, to love is to suffer, not to love is to suffer. To suffer is to suffer. To be happy. One unhappy, therefore, to be unhappy, one must love or love to suffer or suffer from too much happiness. I hope you're getting this down.
I never want to marry. I just want to get divorced.
Very sorry about the technical problems with the sound, but it's an unforgettable dialogue. We have lifted from a very well-known movie, Death and Love, 1945, Woody Allen. La Última Noche de Lori Pushenko. There was the Spanish translation, Love and Death, Amor y Muerte. That was the original title. So you can see the connection. Very creative translation in this case. So I'm sure you understand the connection to this video. Do you understand the connection? No. But we'll get back to this video by the end of the session. I'll try to clarify the connection between Woody Allen and Khalil. So let's see how the doctor, because today and tomorrow we are going to be talking about clear mindfulness and design thinking. And this workshop is a general framework in which we are providing you with fundamental theoretical knowledge which backs up what you do in your classroom in a very intuitive way. So all of you have got a wealth of pedagogical knowledge already in your heads, in your mind, because teachers' minds are nothing but blank slates. We've got a lot of experience teaching many kinds of students, many different groups, for quite a long time in some cases. So all we want to do is to give you pedagogical, theoretical know-how, backing up what you do in your class in an intuitive way. So how do dots connect? There's a close connection between clear mindfulness and design thinking. Mindfulness and design thinking are, we could call them methodologies, different ways of approaching clear. Mindfulness, as you will see, as you will experience tomorrow, is more transversal by nature. And design thinking is a very systematized process that allows us to optimize clear in our classroom. But we get to that tomorrow. We just wanted to highlight from the very start one point, which is that this is a general framework, a general workshop in which we are providing you with basic theoretical knowledge. Actually, we're going to make the dots connect many different ways because Antonio has anticipated some of the principles that we are going to be looking at over the next few minutes. Well, these are the six clear principles that every content teacher, every language teacher working in a bilingual context should keep in mind all the time. Because everything you do or don't do has got an impact on your students' learning. And that is the paramount importance of your imagine. Because your students spend about 6 years in primary education, 4 years in compulsory secondary education, 2 more years in bachillerato, and everything you do or don't do with your students is going to have an impact on their learning. And we are talking about learning all the time. Instilling values related to democracy and how to live together, because those are very important objectives, but you are content or language teachers, and your goal is to make your students learn. Don't forget that. So, these are the six principles
focusing on the first three principles, input from text to tasks, on what I have already anticipated to begin one aspects. Then I will be telling you about scaffolding and lamiaje, very nice word. Scaffolding, as we'll see, is important in clear settings, but is also essential in non-clear settings. And we need to scaffold both content and language, and both input and output. In the middle between input and output, you've got intake, which is what the student gains from the learning experiences that you're giving him or her. And then we talk about dual correspondences, remember? And we posit the potential existence of a fifth C, which could be cooperation, it could be critical thinking skills or creativity. So we think about fifth C. Then we remind you of most exciting, plus and loss. And Christina is going to be reminding you again of the importance of cultivating academic literacy and plural literacy. These are very interesting concepts, which are key to any clear experience. And the last principle is a sort of amalgam of very important things having to do with emotions, with methodology in general, fostering cooperation and rich interaction amongst your students, and collectively. So those are six basic principles. I just wanted you to have the general picture and an overview of the six principles, but now we're going to analyze in detail. Okay, text. This is something that we tend to take for granted, but in our training classes and also in our language classes, EFL classes, I guess there's no language teacher in the room teaching languages other than English. You all teach in English, or through English, or English, per se. Okay. So we deal with a lot of text in our class, basically because we need to give our students input to access disciplinary knowledge. If we want our students to learn history concepts or geography, concepts of philosophy, or maths, whatever, we need to give them input. And we have to be very careful when we select the input that we give our students, because input is the link, is the bridge connecting students and knowledge. We have to make very wise decisions when it comes to selecting input. And then we have to do something about input. Antonio has already mentioned the three stages of the learning process. Students receive input, they process input, and they respond to input in one way or another. Mobilizing different skills, the common use of their skills, are they going to respond to input in writing or speaking to other classmates, in which way? So, from input to text. For our students to be able to process input, to respond to input, we need to transform a text into tasks. And that is a decisive shift. So we select a text, then we have to convert it, transform it into tasks, which are doable tasks. What do I mean by doable tasks? Tasks that our students can accomplish. But remember, this shouldn't be too easy. Otherwise, the learning won't progress any further, and it shouldn't be too difficult. If they are too difficult, the result is going to be frustration for our students. So this should be somewhere in the middle, in a space that we all know is called zone of proximal development. Okay? Zone of proximal development, because it is the cause. But we'll go back to that at a later. So that was the first principle. We should keep in mind that we deal with huge amounts of texts. A video for me is a text. Realia, a garden in the real world, is a text. It's not written in a semiotic system called language. It's written in a different language, but it's still a text, nevertheless. Okay? So we deal with many different kinds of texts, multimodal texts, and we use different channels to access our students' brains, because our students' brains are the learning organ for excellence. We learn through our brain. So many different kinds of texts. Some texts that we use in our classes might be like hieroglyphs to our students. And why have I chosen this image? because some texts, reason in academic language, dealing with concepts of philosophy or biology or chemistry, are simply obscure for our students, and the language is simply impenetrable. Think about your experience as students of biology. Was a text written in academic language in your mother tongue understandable? No. And that's the point I want to emphasize. Academic language in the student's mother tongue is a foreign language already. So if you look at the whole thing from this perspective, you content teachers have got a tremendous challenge in your hands. Because you're teaching academic language, the academic language of your subject, of your discipline, and you're doing that using a foreign language. So the result is a doubly foreign language, a twofold foreign language. So the language is foreign twice. Twice foreign language. So many different kinds of texts. Look at the second one, that's a very simple, accessible kind of text. The second one has got some kind of visual support that might help your students understand the gist of what you want them to learn. And these are all very important things. The typographical layout, the clarity of the message, the kind of concepts that you're going to teach your students using certain kinds of text. So, things to keep in mind. This is a sort of vademecum. You're going to have access to your presentation, so if you don't want to take notes, you don't have to, just for you to get the message here. So things to pay attention to. Text type. What kind of text are you going to choose for your lessons? There are lots of things to consider. Is it a continuous text or is it a discontinuous text? Is it a block of text which is simply impenetrable to your students? Or is it a discontinuous text and you have subheadings, visual support, things that are going to help your students understand? Is it an authentic text that you have lifted, for example, from a web page or from a newspaper article? Or is it an adapted text that you have, for example, lifted from Wikipedia and you have simplified for your students? Is the text a table, a diagram, a graphic, a chart? Has it got non-linguistic elements in it? Is it a language-free text, an artifact, an object, a visual, a garden in the world, a square in the city? And the genre, is it a descriptive text? Is it narrative and history? Is it expositive? Is it argumentative and philosophy? What kind of text do you have in your hands? That's the first question you have to ask yourself. So look at the text layout and scaffolding. Continuous text, digestible chunks. Do you subdivide the text into chunks that are comprehensible to your students? The use of subheading bulleted text. Do you know the concept of bulleted text? Conjuntos, to clarify content. Do you give your students any kind of glossary, timeline, family tree, accompanying the text to clarify the message? And then when it comes to the language of the text, again, there are lots of things to pay attention to. The level of linguistic complexity. If you're teaching biology to first year as a student, the level of language has to be much easier for your students to be able to access the knowledge that you want them to master. Is it adequate in terms of students' level? Look at the length of the sentences and the complexity of the text. Are there too many subordinate sentences, embedded sentences, relative clauses? Lexicon. How many general vocabulary words and subject-specific specialist vocabulary is there in a text? How many different words are there in the text? Then look at the content. Quantum quality and relevance. Is it really the content that you want to teach? Is there a clear division or difference between core concepts and detailed secondary ideas which are not that important? Clarity of the message, is there a logical presentation to the ideas? And last but not least, how is that text converted into tasks? What kind of tasks are they? Remember Antonio's question regarding common tasks that you do in your classes. Is it always a gap fill? Is it always a labeling activity, a matching activity? If you're doing that kind of activity, only that kind of activity, you are cultivating all your loss. And you're not moving towards the summit of the pyramid, towards hearts. You're not taking the your students outside their comfort zone and pushing them towards the zone of practical development. Do the tasks that you use with your students really promote rich interaction and dialogical learning? Do students have opportunities to language, to express their understanding of concepts? Is there an integrated and balanced approach to all the skills in the Common European Framework of Reference? Are you doing too many reading, comprehension activities, listening activities? Are you completely forgetting production activities? And can I be interested? Are you giving your students the content that you want them to acquire, to master, and the language to talk and to write about that content? That is as important as giving your students the content. So remember, content teachers have to keep an eye on the content they want to teach, but also on the academic language that the students need to be able to successfully process knowledge. And that's very challenging. There's one more comment stream about scaffolding comes in the language in the language. So this is the English classroom. And it seems that today, during the core lesson, scaffolding went down. Scaffolding is very important. It's an essential, powerful tool for learning. And it's even more important in a clear context, because your students need a lot of support. Of course, you're not giving them support all the time. There will be a point at which you have to set them free somehow. So, this is a very lengthy definition of scaffolding. I've drawn on different sources and put the key aspects together for you to have a very comprehensive definition. So this is scaffolding. Effective scaffolding consists of a variety of temporary measures. We're not scaffolding students learning all the time. At some point, they have to navigate on their own. Measures and mechanisms that foster critical thinking as well as learning, engagement, and autonomy. It can be offered to students by teachers or other adults and or by learning materials. That's why the first decision that you make, which is choosing input and tasks, is of the essence. Scaffolding is used to help construct cognitively and linguistically challenging learning environments that support students in engaging with and complete meaningful tasks. Scaffolding supports students in progressively moving towards not only improving their knowledge and skills base because you're content teachers, but also becoming more independent learners. And it helps students to stretch their thinking, to reach beyond what they could do on their own, and it seeks to place students in a space or a zone where they are constantly intellectually challenged, by also being supported and going further in their thinking. And this phase is called zone of proximal development, that's Vygotsky. In core lessons in language input and output are not scaffolded, the maximum potential of the zone of proximal development cannot be realized. Simple as that. So you have to scaffold both input and output, and you have to keep an eye on language and content. Otherwise, why bother? Why teach chemistry through English? Because we want our students to learn chemistry, at the same time we want them to have a good command of the language they need to think about, to talk about, to write about chemistry in the second language and in the mother tongue. So these are just a few examples of ways of scaffolding content and language input and output. You can use the first language, translanguaging and code switching. Remember Alberto's presentation yesterday, switching from one code to another. Don't know whether you have realized that the video that we have played for you, the one that we have taken from Woody Allen, had subtitles in Polish. Because we didn't want you to read subtitles in English. You can play a video in English and you can discuss it in Spanish or the other way around. I use it all the time in my own lessons. You can read aloud, you can use gestures and modeling, you can connect background knowledge to your students' prior knowledge. You can use graphic organizers, visuals, reality, lots of things you can do to support both content and language acquisition. And the third principle
designing a lesson, a pre-lesson, there are four basic ingredients you have to bear in mind. The first one is C for content. And that's our first C, and that's our top priority, because we got content teachers. CLIL is a content-driven approach. And what I mean by content-driven approach is that we have to keep in mind that we have to teach content. And our students have to meet certain curriculum demands and expectations. So we have to keep our learning outcomes on the horizon all the time. The second C stands for communication, remember? So we need to give our students language of learning, which is vocabulary, structures, genres. They need to deal with knowledge in our subject. We need to give them language for learning, a language which they need to interact with each other, and through learning, language through learning, which is the language that emerges in a classroom setting when your students are interacting with each other. That's why we call a language triptych, a diptico linguistico, language of learning, for learning, and through learning. That's a classic already. Then we have the third C, which stands for cognition. Remember? Blocks and pots, what kind of mechanisms are activated in your students' minds. And the last C is for culture. Okay? There could be a fifth C. It could stand for creativity, or critical thinking, or cooperation, or collaboration. Just think about a fifth C. So up to now, we have analyzed three basic principles. Which was the first principle? From text to doable tasks. Principle number two? A scaffolding, both content and language, both input and output. Principle number three, forces. Are we really calculating forces in our three lessons? And now we move on to principle number four, which is, you already know about this. Should I tell you again? You know that, right?
Yes.
You've been hearing about that?
Or? Yes, we did it yesterday.
Okay. There are 19 cognitive, 19, almost 20 cognitive processes, cognitive skills that any learner needs to do. What Bloom did in the 50s was to rearrange those 19, almost 20 skills into these six steps. He did that in the 50s. It was at the beginning of the 20th century when two scholars decided to rearrange it, and they reorganized it. They changed the first two steps at the bottom. Understanding was at the beginning and remembering was the second one. So they switched it and they changed the label of each of the steps into verbs. These are the changes they did. What is implied in these lots and hots from bottom to high level thinking skills? Well, what is key is that you need to start from the bottom, but you cannot stay there. If you stay there, nothing happens in your students, in your learners' rooms. Their learning will be surface learning. They will walk out the door and they will forget about what they were doing with you in class. Because you are not engaging them in doing something, I would say, challenging. And one more thing, and this was something that my colleague was talking about. They are in their comfort zone. Oh, the teacher is just asking me to do this. Okay, I'll do that. That's okay. But you are not pushing them into a zone which is a bit discomforting. And this zone, which is a bit discomforting, as my colleague said, is the zone of proximal development. So you need to create tasks which are doable
and in which you start from the bottom and you keep on challenging them. So this is the essence of it. I will not say anything else about that. All right, questions? Well, the next principle, the fifth principle, this is related to focusing on the language, not the content. What is the problem? That your students will not learn the language by osmosis, just by being in contact. Nothing happens. You need to do something else. What can you do? Make the language visible. How do I do that? Well, you use scaffolding techniques and you make visible text structure. You make visible discourse patterns. You make visible genres. So everything that I am commenting on in this principle is something that somehow was connected, not somehow, was connected without any somehow, what my colleague Leonard was talking about, was mentioning, was explaining about from text to tasks, that input. Academic registers. In academic registers, for example, we have fact-based versus opinion-based. So if I provide any text, is it just facts? Or is it an opinion? Is it an argumentation? Or is it an emotional text or an emotional text? So all these, if you don't make it visible, if you don't make your students, your learners think about that, it will not come up. You have to pinpoint that or help them get to that idea on their own. But you need to ask the right questions. And this is it. For example, in the type of text that you use for your discipline, do you usually have a third person use? Or do you usually have a third person avoidance? For example, do you use passive sentences? But you need to make it visible. Or the use of passive voice versus active voice, depending on the type of text. But if we don't make it visible, if we don't ask the right questions so that they infer, or any activity in which they have to realize that that is happening, it will not come to their minds. That is regarding academic registers, connectors. Which type of connectors do we have when we are in a lab? Well, maybe you need to explain a lab procedure. So process, first, you use imperatives, do this. Second, third, next, finally. Or if you are giving pros and cons with one hand, on the other hand. But if you don't provide that, you won't be able to do that by osmosis, as I said. Phrases for analysis.
Sorry, what do you mean by making this go, for example, with passive voices? Like, make them aware of you're using passive voice? Or
you don't actually need to mention the label passive voice, but you can call their attention. Hey, have you ever seen that? What do you think that means? For example, and then you can have like the structure of the sentence in whatever, you can show it on the screen, right on the blackboard. Like, well, take a look at this sentence and that other sentence. What do you notice, which is different here? Like, you don't really need to say, and then the agent, and then the passive voice, and then just make them think about that. Why do you think this is so? Which is the different meaning that you have if you have this one or the other one? Asking them to elicit it. Phrases for analysis, kind of the same thing. If you know that in your discipline, you've got like set phrases that you always find have a kind of glossary with different activities, but if you don't put them to their reach, you won't be able to get those. And discussion, of course, it's not that I give you and you do, it's that you answer back, that you engage, that you do something with it. Or for example, frames and models for writing and speaking. So if you don't agree with someone who is explaining the procedure in the lab, how do you say that you don't agree? If you don't tell them? Okay, now this person is going to explain the procedure. If you notice that there is any step missing, put your hand up and disagree and add the missing step. But how do you disagree? They need to know. Or if they have to come up with a description of a river, is it okay to give them another description of a river as an example? They need models. They need models.
Sorry, it is supposed that these things are being done by a content teacher or by linguistic teacher?
Content, usually if you can, with the help of language teachers. Collaboration is essential. It is essential, if possible. In the real world, sometimes it is not possible. But yes, it is good. The more you collaborate with linguistic teachers, the better. If there is synergy. If there is no synergy. But it is, all of us are learners of languages. We are learners of languages. And we as learners sometimes have an intuitive knowledge of what it takes for me to get this idea, to get that structure, to be able to write this text correctly. What do I need if I want to write a letter for another school? Well, I need to go into the internet and find a model for a letter. Why can't we allow our students to do the same thing? So, and this is the fifth principle. The last one, well, not the last one. Another resource, I was talking about texts. And we were saying that text is anything, but sometimes texts are not codified in a linguistic system. Sometimes a text is, as Leonard said, a garden. That is a text. That is not a linguistic text. I would say an ecological text. A natural text.
Experimental.
So sometimes we also have information and we have to manage information. We have to manage content which is not expressed with words. It is expressed with statistics, graphic organizers, graphs, visual prompts. So you have to, any time you come, try to help them be able to read, interpret those texts as well. Because most usually, some of those will be, I would say, very specific even for your content subjects. So combining those will also help students who have multiple intelligences as well. So it is essential to help them decode those texts, that information, and interpret that, not only a text with words. Make use of that, because you will engage other students as well. And the last one, one more idea here. When you make the content and the language of your content visible, it is essential that you try to keep an unbalanced so not this, but this between the language and the content. That means that the more difficult the content is, the less difficult the language should be. And the other way around, if the language is very difficult, make sure that the content, the ideas, is easy. And that takes me, you wanted to make a picture? And that takes me to the last principle at last. This is something that my colleague Elena Gomez was talking about the first day. So I'm not going to explain anything new to you, but just to let you know, to revise with you, to summarize these five good, I would say, characteristics and benefits from cooperative learning: positive interdependence, face-to-face promotive interaction, individual and group accountability, interpersonal and small group skills, and group processing. Learners learn when they do something, and they have to do something in relation to others, the same as we do have to do things in our schools in relation to the rest of our colleagues. The same as we need to reach agreements with our family when we want to choose the place where we want to go for holidays, because that is real life. And by doing this, we are teaching them the skills that they need for real life, not only for our content subjects. And that is essential. But there is something else that I want to highlight today, which is the importance of having an asymmetry in classroom talk. How much do you talk? Do you speak in class? I speak a lot in general. When I am in class, I think that I even speak more. And that is a problem. If we keep on speaking, we keep on producing. The more I produce, the less my students produce. So, ideally, student talking time should be much bigger than my talking time. And this is precisely what Antonio, that is precisely what he was talking about in the previous session. How much have I been doing? How much have I been explaining? All he was doing was preparing the activity, organizing, then they are doing it. So if they need to write a letter for another school, now we can make sure that we provide some ideas and now. And finally, and this connects strongly with what we will be doing tomorrow in the mindfulness session. If our students believe that by making mistakes they are a failure, if they believe that they cannot make a mistake, if they are afraid, if they receive a sarcastic commentary either from you or from other learners, our students would learn. So we need to make sure that the environment in the lesson, in your lessons, is safe. And that means that's okay to make mistakes. That's okay. And to know that having an emotional response to something is also okay. Being angry, being sad, being whatever, that's okay. And we can solve the problem, we can solve the situation cooperating, helping each other, not laughing at the one who is whatever. So this is essential. And this is it. I don't want to keep on taking your time with this theoretical explanation that takes up, in the end, so much time, because we want you to experience what we have been talking about theoretically, which we already think that you know. So, if you want to explain the activity.
Well, at this point, I think we should apologize for giving you so much information in just 35 minutes, something like that. We're very sorry for that, but we wanted you to have a clear map so that you can navigate clear lessons, clear units, and materials on your own autonomously. So under different circumstances, we wouldn't have done this way. We would probably have used cooperative strategies, but we wanted to convey a wealth of information for you to take away when you leave this room. So now we're going to put a cooperative learning strategy in practice for the rest of our session. We're going to do a jigsaw activity. We're going to be working in expert groups first, and then you'll go back to a base group later on. Every expert group is going to focus on the analysis of history resources for a clear classroom from a different perspective. So I'm going to give you materials, but first of all, let me give you instructions. So in groups of five, you're going to focus on one particular task that we're going to give you. And you're going to analyze a set of materials, history materials, just focusing on the kind of language, the kind of tasks, the kind of instructions that those materials give to your students. And there will be a group of experts, an expert group, working on clearing sentences. So seven groups of five expert groups. And each expert group is going to be working on just one question. 20 minutes later, after 20 minutes of intensive work, you're going back to your base group. In every base group, there should be one expert on each topic, and we'll have about 25 minutes to share knowledge. So every person in the group should speak for about 3-4 minutes, no more. So by the end of this activity, this dynamic, you will have the whole picture in your head. The object, the focus of our analysis is going to be a set of materials for our history clear lesson. And we are going to exploit it, analyze it from a different perspective. Each group is going to be focusing on one single aspect. You see the point? So at the end of this jigsaw activity, every person in every base group is going to have the general overall photograph of the critical analysis. This is a time-consuming activity. We're not going to spend any more time giving you instructions, so let's start straight away. So let us, have you got a materials already?
Yes. Yeah.
So we need you to form groups of five. Okay, so you five can work together. You five together, you're good.
Which was But you need to agree on that. Now, group number two. You go to another place, another area, and then you do the same.
Anyone?
Anyone. You choose. If your handwriting is small, use this one. If your handwriting is huge, use that one. All right? But you decide where. You decide. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. You guys in 5 need to convince everyone in your base groups of your 3 top ideas from the quintessential chips. And you need to put it here. Alright?
So every person in every group should take about 2 to 3 minutes to talk about the strengths and weaknesses in relation to content-driven communication, cognition, scaffolding, tasking, instructions, whatever. You could start here at this point and move clockwise. And the area in the middle in the center is for clear essentials. So every person who is an expert in clear essentials will send the 3 key aspects to the rest of the group. But every person should speak for about 2 or 3 minutes.
Explain your conclusions.
Presenting the conclusions drawn by every expert group.
So in the end, when you decide your place matters. In the end, when you have finished in your placements, you will have your personal, but also your collective analysis of those 2 pieces of paper that we gave you in a copy from these history materials. All right? Mom, 2 minutes per person. 2, 3.
Opportunities to
language to express their understanding of the content that you expect them to acquire, to master by the end of the lesson. It could have been a text about the Industrial Revolution, about the Roman Empire. It's simply, I mean, I would say it's an impossible battle to win if you don't facilitate your students' understanding. Scaffold. There's very little scaffolding in this material, by the way. The text could be a very good starting point. You could adapt it. You should analyze it in your departments with the help of language teachers, really to foster cooperation across departments and secondary schools. It's a good text as a point of departure, but then you should adapt it to your to suit your students.
Visual division.
Use chunks, different chunks of text.
Subtitles,
subheadings, and so on and so forth. So, just let me draw your attention to a few conclusions. The most important thing for you is to take these six fundamental clear principles with you. Now, you know how to look at materials and resources from a critical perspective. So your look is not going to be innocent anymore. That was one of the important lessons we wanted you to do.
No, you're not innocent.
Well, the power of scaffolding to propel learning forward. Now you have realized there's very little scaffolding. This material is just a family tree. There's a glossary. This material is intended for Italian-speaking students. So very little scaffolding, just a glossary and a family tree, and that's it. That's the end of the story. But you know, you now know that you have to scaffold content and language, and input and output. Well, you have to take students outside their comfort zone, from box to box. That colleague and that group at the back said that if you analyze the task instructions very closely, you will realize that you're only cultivating blocks, not many parts. So what kind of cognitive processes are you activating in your students' minds? Are they really progressing along the content and language pathways? Well, clear textbooks are far from perfect. So in an ideal world, in an ideal bilingual school, content teachers and language teachers would work together and would produce their own material. Of course, this takes time. But at least now, you know how to look at material for a critical scan, and that's very important. You're taking a very tiny vademecum with you in the form of six principles that you can apply to any kind of material assessment. Designing materials is even more complex. We don't have the time, we don't have the ability, the aptitude to do that. Actually, you've got Oxford University Press, Cambridge University Press, people who know a lot about teaching, and that come up with this kind of material, which is not perfect, as we have already seen. So, and we have a little surprise for you, well, just to wrap up the session.
To finish, we want to invite you to play with us for a couple of minutes. Do you have your